This is chapter number 6, Peasants and Farmers. Last discussion we had for England, what were the condition of peasants and farmers in late 18th and early 19th century. Now I'll discuss about USA, United States of America. And in this place, the modern agriculture took place, that is, the modernization of agriculture took place, because of which the name bread basket was given to this place. Now, what was this bread basket? At the same time where the common fields were enclosed, the boundary were being made, and that too you can say supported by the government in England, that is at the end of the 18th century. In USA, the agriculture was not that popular, you can say, or not being done. If you need to know the situation here, this is the map or a thematic map showing that forests cover over 800 million acres and grasslands 600 million acres. So this is the vegetation, forest and grasslands in USA before the westward expansion of white settlers. So previously there were only natives living here, right? And these are the names of the, say, the native, those used to inhabit this place, those communities, native communities. Now let me take some of the names like Blackfoot, Crow, Mandan, Cheyenne, Pawnee, Shawnee, Iroquois, and this Chicksaw, Comanche, Choctaw, Creek, and Seminole. Now, the basic thing is, at that time, if you see this dark green, these are the forest vegetation. Little less green is the tall grasses area, and these are short grasses, and these are deserts. So most of the landscape were not under the control of white Americans. Till the 1780s, these white American settlements, they were only confined to this small strip here, very small strip. They used to live here. But the nomadic, that is those who were the natives here, they used to live in these places, as I showed you. These are the various regions they inhabit, and they used to do like hunting, gathering fishes, and they used to cultivate corn, beans, tobacco, and pumpkin. And some were expert trappers, and they would sell to European traders the supplies of beaver fur in the 16th century. And these are the location, as I told you, these are different tribes which were here, the natives. But if you see that this is 1920, the agriculture belts in USA is shown here. This is the area of wheat area. There are other belt also, like corn belt, corn and wheat belt. So mostly wheat and wheat areas are like this. Other regions like pasture region, this is the cotton belt, and this is the subtropical coast. Then we have desert, etc. here. Mostly this is the region we will talk about. And the landscape now, by the early 20th century, it changed dramatically, radically. Now the Americans, that is the white Americans, those were only staying here. Now they shifted to the west, and they displaced the local tribes. The USA had come to dominate the world market in agriculture produced, mainly the grains. So how does it happen, and what happened to the natives? We'll talk about that. So as I said, there was a westward move, and the story of this agrarian expansion, that is the expansion of the whites, is very much connected to the westward movement of the white settlers who took over the land. There was an war, American Independence War, from 1775 to 1783, and then USA was formed, United States of America. The white Americans now begin to move westward, that is, from this place, now they started moving to the west side. And at this time, Thomas Jefferson, he became the president of USA in 1800, and over 700, you can say 7 lakhs, you know, 700,000 white settlers had moved on to the Appalachian Plateau through various passes. Right? Now, this, what they moved and they turned these land into cultivated fields. Now, forest timber could be cut for export, animal hunted for skin, mountains mined for gold and minerals. That means that American Indians had to be cleared from the land. Basically, the natives were called as Indians. The natives, that the tribes, different tribes I showed you, they were called as Indians. So they need to be moved. Now, in 1800, the US government made policies driving these natives, those who were inhabiting for so long, American Indians, they were shifted westwards. That is, first beyond the river Mississippi and then further west. Most of them waged war and they were massacred. Many houses or villages were burned. The Indians actually resisted. That is, most of the Indians, they were killed and their houses were burned, villages were burned, but the Indians resisted. But they had some victories, but ultimately they were forced to sign certain treaties and they had to give their land and they moved westward. So this is the area, if you see the expansion of the whites, this is the area they used to live, that is the white settlement, only very small strip. In 1775, now they expanded the area. In the 1850, they came here also, even expanded the area, and finally by 1920, all blue, that is all white settlement. Now, as the Indian, they retreated, the settlers came in and they settled on the Appalachian Plateau, that is the settlers, white settlers, by the first decade of the 18th century. Then they also moved into Mississippi Valley between 1820 and 1850. Now they burned and slashed and cut the forest, pulled out the stumps. They wanted to cultivate, so they cleared the land for cultivation. That is, forests were being cleared. And they cleared large area and also they made a boundary, that is, they erected fence around their field. And now those fields, they are sowing corn and wheat. If I can show you the house, this is the sod house in the frontier, just for an example, that this house is made by mud and the grass. There is a word called sod, pieces of earth with grass. So this is the house being made by grass of the white settlers. In the early years, what happened? The soil was fertile, so there were good crops. But when the soil loses or lost its fertility, that is, it was impoverished and exhausted, the migrant would move now even to the west. They wanted new land and they need to, or they wanted to raise new crops. And only after 1860s, these settlers swept into the Great Plains across the river Mississippi. And then after that, the region which we are talking about become the major wheat producing area of America. That is, wheat producing basket of which we started. That is why we started saying bread basket. Because this, at this time, this region is the major wheat producing area of America. So we need to understand how this happened. How America was being called as the breadbasket of America, and what were the challenges they faced, what were the consequences happened. So we will talk about these farmers. This is a very typical family on Sunday afternoon showing a picture of Great Plains of Dakota in the first decades of the 20th century. So the wheat farmers, there was a dramatic expansion in the late 19th century of wheat production in USA. The urban population was growing in USA and the export market was also becoming higher, even bigger. As the demand was increasing for the food, wheat prices were increasing, and this encouraged the farmers to produce even more wheat. And then came the railway. When the railway came, it was easy now to transport the grain from the wheat growing regions for export to the eastern coast. So this again became higher, and during the First World War, when Russia supplies were cut off from the Europe, now the Europe is dependent on USA for its feed, for all the grains, etc., and the wheat. I'll just tell you one sentence which US President Wilson said that will sum up this all, that plant more wheat. He urged the farmers that plant more wheat. Wheat will win the war. So in 1910, 45 million acres of land expanded after 9 years to 75 million acres for wheat. That is around 65% enhancement. And most of the increase was in Great Plains, where there were new areas and they were plowed to extend the cultivation. And if you if you can imagine, big farmers, they own more than 2,000 to 3,000 acres of land, one person. So this was the age of new technology. They used the new technology, they invented new technology, right? That is, previously they used to do everything using the hand. And those areas which we are talking about, they had those land have very tough roots. Those grass were having tough roots. And so in order to break this sod and turn the soil over for plowing, means making it fit for the cultivation, new plows or plows were devised locally. Some of them, if you see here, they were 12 feet long. And their front rested on a small wheel, if you see, and they were hitched on to six yokes of oxen or six horses. I'll show you a picture also. Now, with this, by the early 20th century, farmers in the Great Plains, which we are talking about, they were actually breaking the ground with tractors and disc plows. They were clearing vast stretches for wheat cultivation. But once this is done, once crop is being ripened, there is always a need to harvest. And as I said, previously they used cradle or sickle before the 1830s. And this would need a lot of men to work for, women to work for. But there was an event, or you can say a creation. In 1831, Cyrus McCormick, he invented the first mechanical reaper. This mechanical reaper would cut in one day the same amount of crop that 16 men with sickle would do. So now they have technology. And with these machines, 500 acres of wheat could be harvested in just 15 days, 2 weeks. So now, apart from this, the new machines were there, and they were able to cultivate so much, and the work could be done quickly with bare number of hands, means minimum number of labor. And as we said that these machines were power driven machinery, and only 4 men could plow, seed and harvest all the three things, 2000 to 4000 acres of wheat in just one season. So this was the level of technology being used, and that is why people, that is the labor, was not required. So this shows what happened to the poor. So before we go what happened to the poor, let me tell you what the scene or the event, what we need to know in the pictorial form. So this was the era where the sickles or the hand were used to cut the grass, to prepare the field. Then after that, these are the breaking plows before the age of mechanization. See, so many horses, etc. are being used here. Then here we have the technology, seeding with drills and tractors. This is a highland farm in North Dakota, 1910. And here we have more advancement. This is breaking the ground on the Great Plains in North Dakota, 1910. So this is called the Minneapolis steam tractor. Now what happened to the poor? The only thing is that because the machinery came, the poor farmer, because they couldn't find job. So now they can't find the job and they face trouble. And there was a case that the production has expanded rapidly because of the mechanization, and during the war also and post-war years also. Now the grain or the wheat was in surplus. It was so much that the storehouses overflowed with grain. Animal would feed. Means people were giving them to animal. And wheat prices fell because of the immense, stock. And export markets collapsed. And which we learn in the previous discussion, the Great Agrarian Depression in 1930s in USA, this has come. That is, this was one of the reason why this happened. Because of the surplus amount of wheat, because of the people were making it, people were cultivating it, and the laborers were less. Laborers are required less. So this happened to the poor. Now one more thing happened. Dust bowl. This is a twister. This is a black blizzard in western Kansas, which was pictured on 14th April 1935. So this blizzard can show you what is the gravity, what is the impact it will have on these very small, tiny looking homes and the fields. In 1930s, how the breadbasket changed to dust bowl. So in 1930s, terrifying dust storms, as you see here, began to blow over the southern plains. These blizzards rolled in very often 7,000 to 8,000 high feet. They were monstrous waves of muddy water. They come day after day through 1930s. And when they came, the skies darkened like it is a night time. The dust would swept in, people are blinded, choked, cattle are suffocated to death because the lungs caked or filled with dust and mud. And all the things like the birds and animals, even the fish died. And the tractors and machine which the people owned or the farmer owned were just clogged with dust and they were damaged beyond repair. So this is a picture being made by Alexander Home. He presented what happened when the blizzard passes, when the blizzard is over. Everything vanishes. Everything is unusable now. Now what had gone wrong? Why this blizzard has taken place? See, the main idea is in the early 1930s, there were persistent drought because the rain failed and the temperature became very high and the temperatures soared. Now the wind blew with ferocious speed. If there is ordinary dust storms, this will not cause that much harm. But because the land were so open, the wheat cultivation, because if you have, say, trees or some grass, those roots will hold the soil. But now because there were huge number of land of cultivation, and there were no grass there, no trees, these upper soil, you can say, the soil on the crust, they will come up with this dust storm and this will cause the black blizzard. So this is an idea that many people think that this is the reason why this black blizzard came. So after that, really, the US people and everyone realized that they need to respect the ecological conditions, because they were just cultivating weed without even thinking about the result. And this result was black wizard. This is how the bread basket converted to the dust bowl. And we will talk about the Indian farmers and opium production. First, we have seen the Indian peasants and farmer. Then we talked about just now about USA. And the Indian farmer and opium we'll talk about in the next discussion. Till then, thank you so much. Take care of yourself.